is prevention planning. How do you move from steady state into prevention planning to avoid deterrence and ultimately combat operations? Finding that if we can deter early on, we don't have to pay a big price later on for a military intervention. So everybody's focused on that right now. What we did was the five sectoral tasks, looked through that list, and there are about 1,200 tasks in the list, so it's not like reading. And identify those tasks are grouped right now based on the initial response, the transformation period response, and then what you do at tail end, fostering its sustainability. What they did not do in that task list is identify any agency or any organization that would actually perform the task. And the cross-sectoral tasks, as I said before, are not yet developed. And one other problem we noted when we went through this is the strategic communication is embedded in each of the sector tasks. So there's no insurance that what's said in each of these sector tasks will have a big staple put through to make sure they're all consistent when the message goes out to the communities. And that could cause a lot of difficulty. We recommended probably they ought to add another cross-sectoral area called strategic communication. What we did to this post-conflict reconstruction essential task force, GRIDLE, another unpronounceable acronym, we started with that. We arranged it in a hierarchical order by function, activity, task, and subtasks, so there was some order to it. When necessary, we added pieces of work to make the work breakdown structure valid. In some cases, assessments were not done before you implemented, so you really have to go back one step and what are you going to do first, and then once you figure that out, then do it. Also, we found that some other agencies had looked at these tasks and looked at the operations, identified other tasks. The UN Peacekeeping Handbook was one that had some additional tasks in it. And then what we did also was added three echelons of governance. We recognized that some tasks are inherently the function of a national level government, the customs, the manipulation of currencies, things like that. However, there are some that are at the provincial and municipal level that city managers, organizations that deal with detailed issues at very, very low level have their responsibility to do. There's another piece of the task in this set that deal with tactical issues. That immediate humanitarian assistance after the combat forces have passed through an area and the immediate assistance to start establishing some semblance of governance. And we identified those as tasks in this list as well and separated them out. And based on the assessment of the agency capabilities, we identified where the federal agencies that had the competencies could do a task or subtask, or where state and local authorities possibly could provide some capability. We did not identify which agency would be the lead agency or which one would be supporting. That's something that the PCCs have to resolve internally. This is an example of what a list looks like. We started with the basic list, and then we reorganized it into a hierarchical array where we have the different color codes reflecting which piece was at what level and also whether it was an add-on to what was already existing. So we could easily identify and point to it. We numbered the tasks because they had not been numbered, so we could refer to them easily instead of writing out the whole task description. And then we established the three levels of response. That way we could identify which agencies at what level could provide some capability. The recommendation was that the sub-PCCs take this information, sit down with those agencies and figure out, just as they did with the National Response Plan, or the emergency support functions, which one is the lead agency for that task, which are the supporting agencies, and work out the details of the information requirements and the authorities that are necessary to do it. The way ahead, Unified Action, LOE, series is continuing. We're getting more understanding of what the issues and complexities are, and we're continuing to develop in that area. additional tasks need to be out, cross-sectoral functions, and for strategic communication. And training requirements are being identified as we go through this. What sort of training is necessary for the new National Security Officer program that the federal government has got? Eric Conrad at NDU has got a mandate to go ahead and start establishing that curriculum. I saw the executive order just came out in June. So he's in the process of writing the curriculum so he can set up for that. The document itself took 4 months to produce. It took a year to go through the vetting process with all the agencies to get their comments in. And then another 6 months on top of that to get the issues on releasability resolved. So we just published it, it's releasable, it's inbound, UN gets it, other non-governmental organizations, non-governmental organizations, U.S. government can get it, and certain academic institutions can get it. So it's available, and it took a long time to get it done, but it's good through March of 07, so we updated in that process. Be glad to talk to anybody about this in the panel session. Thank you.